Hello, my darling, and welcome to today's story time. Please make sure to subscribe. And now, on with our story time. Arria Marcella made a sign to Octavian to lie down upon the black linium beside her and share her repast. Half maddened with astonishment and love, the young man took at random a few mouthfuls from the plates extended to him by little curly-haired slaves who wore short tunics. Arria did not eat, but she frequently raised to her lips an opal-tinted mirrene vase filled with a wine, darkly purple like thickened blood. As she drank, an imperceptible rosy vapor mounted to her cheeks from her heart, the heart that had never throbbed for so many centuries. Nevertheless, her bare arm, which Octavian lightly touched in the act of raising his cap, was cold as the skin of a serpent or the marble of a tomb. "Ah," she exclaimed, when he paused in the study museum to contemplate the mass of hardened clay, which still preserves my form. She turned her long, liquid eyes upon Octavian. "And your thoughts were ardently directed to me. My spirit felt it in that world where I float, invisible to vulgar eyes. Faith makes God, and love makes woman. One is truly dead when one is no longer loved. Your desire has restored life to me. The mighty invocation of your heart overcame the dim distances that separated us." The idea of amorous invocation which the young woman spoke of entered into the philosophic beliefs of Octavian, beliefs which we ourselves are not far from sharing. In effect, nothing dies. All things are eternal. No power can annihilate that which once had been. Every action, every word, every thought which has fallen into the universal ocean of being therein creates circles which travel and increase in traveling even to the confines of eternity. To vulgar eyes only do natural forms disappear, and the specters which have thence detached themselves people infinity, Paris, in some unknown region of space, continues to carry off Helen. The galley of Cleopatra still floats down with swelling sails of silk upon the azure current of the ideal Cydnus. A few passionate and powerful minds have been able to recall before them ages apparently long passed away, and to restore to life personages dead to all the world beside. Faust has had for his mistress the daughter of Tyndarus, and conducted her to his Gothic castle in the depths of the mysterious abysses of Hades. Octavian had been able to live a day under the reign of Titus, and to make himself beloved of Arria Marcella, daughter of Arius Diomedes. She, who was at that moment lying upon an antique couch beside him in a city destroyed for all the rest of the world. "From my disgust with other women," replied Octavian, "from the unconquerable reverie which attracted me toward its radiant shapes as to stars that lure on, I knew that I could never love save beyond the confines of time and space. It was you that I awaited, and that frail vestige of your being, preserved by the curiosity of men, has by its secret magnetism placed me in communication with your spirit. I know not if you be a dream or reality, a phantom or a woman. If, like Ixion, I press but a cloud to my cheated breast. If I am only the victim of some vile spell of sorcery. But what I do truly know is that you will be my first and my last love. May Eros, son of Aphrodite, hear your promise," returned Arria Marcella, dropping her head upon the shoulder of her lover, who lifted her in a passionate embrace. "Oh, Press me to your young breast. Envelop me with your warm breath. I am cold through having remained so long without love. And against his heart, Octavian felt that beautiful bosom rise and fall, whose mold he had that very morning admired through the glass of a cabinet in the museum. The coolness of that beautiful flesh penetrated him through his tunic and made him burn. The gold and black filigree had become detached from Arya's head, passionately thrown back, and her hair streamed like a black river over the purple pillow. The slaves had removed the table. A confused sound of sighs and kisses was alone audible. The pet quails, indifferent to the amorous scene, plundered the crumbs of the banquet upon the mosaic pavement, uttering sharp little cries. Suddenly, the brazen rings of the curtain which closed the entrance to the apartment slid back upon the curtain rod, and an aged man of stern demeanor and wrapped in a great brown mantle appeared upon the threshold. His gray beard was divided into two points after the manner of the Nazarenes. His face seemed furrowed by the suffering of aesthetic mortifications, and a little cross of black wood was suspended from his neck, leaving no doubt as to his faith. He belonged to the sect, then new, of the Disciples of Christ. On perceiving him, Arria Marcella, overwhelmed with confusion, hid her face in the folds of her mantle, like a bird which puts its head under its wing at the approach of an enemy from whom it cannot escape, to save itself at least from the horror of seeing him, while Octavian, rising on his elbow, stared fixedly at the provoking being who had thus abruptly interrupted his happiness. "Arria, Arria!" exclaimed the austere personage in the voice of reproach. "Did not your lifetime suffice for your misconduct? And must your infamous amours encroach upon centuries to which they do not belong? Can you not leave the living in their sphere? Have not your ashes cooled since the day when you perished, unrepentant, beneath the rain of volcanic fire? So then, even 2,000 years have not sufficed to calm your passion, and your voracious arms still draw to your heartless breast of marble the poor madmen whom your breasts have intoxicated. Arius, father, mercy. Do not crush me in the name of that morose religion which was never mine. I believed in our ancient gods, who loved life and youth and beauty and pleasure. Do not hurl me back into pale nothingness. Let me enjoy this life that love has given back to me. Silence, impious woman. Speak not to me of your gods, which are demons. Let this man, whom you have fettered with your impure seductions, depart hence. Draw him no more beyond the circle of that life which God measured out for him. Return to the limbo of paganism with your Asiatic, Roman, and Greek lovers. Young Christian, forsake that larva, who would seem to you more hideous than Empusa or Phorcus, could you but see her as she is. Pale and frozen with horror, Octavian tried to speak, but his voice clung to his throat, according to the expression of Virgil. "Will you obey me, Arria?" the tall man cried imperiously. "No, never," responded Arria. Her eyes flashed, her nostrils dilated, and with passion-trembling lips, she suddenly encircled the body of Octavian with her beautiful, statuesque arms, cold, hard, and rigid as marble. Her furious beauty, enhanced by the struggle, shone forth at that supreme moment with supernatural brightness, as though to leave its imperishable souvenir with her young lover. "Then, unhappy woman," exclaimed the old man, "I must needs employ extreme measures and render your nothingness palpable and visible to this fascinated child. and in a voice of command he pronounced a formula of exorcism that banished from Arya's cheeks the purple tints with which the black wine from the vase had suffused them. At that same moment, the distant bell of one of those hamlets which border the seacoast or lie hidden in the mountain hollows rang out the first peal of the Angelus. A sob of agony burst from the broken heart of the young woman at that sound. Octavian felt her encircling arms untwine. The draperies which covered her sank fold on fold, as though the contours which had sustained them had suddenly given way, and the wretched night walker beheld on the banquet couch beside him only a handful of cinders, mingled with a few fragments of calcined bones, among which gold bracelets and jewelry glittered, together with other such shapeless remains as were found in excavating the via of Arius Diomedes. He uttered one fearful cry and became insensible. The old man had disappeared. The sun rose, and the hall, so brilliantly decorated but a short time before, became only a dismantled ruin. After a heavy slumber, inspired by the libations of the previous evening, Max and Fabio started from their sleep and at once called their comrade, whose room adjoined their own, with one of those burlesque rallying cries which are so commonly made use of by travelers. Octavian, for the best of reasons, returned no answer. Fabio and Max, hearing no response, entered their friend's chamber and perceived that the bed had not been disturbed. "He must have fallen asleep in some chair," said Fabio, "without being able to get to bed, for our good Octavian cannot bear much liquor, and most likely he's taking an early walk to dissipate the fumes of the wine in the fresh morning air." "No," said Max, "he did not drink much. All this seems very strange to me. Let us go and find him." Accompanied by the cicerone, the two friends searched all the streets, squares, crossroads, and alleys of Pompeii, entering every curious building where they thought Octavian might be occupied in copying a painting or taking down an inscription, and finally discovered him lying insensible upon the disjointed mosaic pavement of a small, ruined chamber. They had much difficulty in restoring him to consciousness, and on reviving, his only explanation of the circumstance was that he had taken a fancy to see Pompeii by moonlight, and had been seized with a sudden faintness, which would doubtless result in nothing serious. The little party returned by rail to Naples, as they had come, and the same evening from their private box at the San Carlo, Max and Fabio watched through their opera glasses a troupe of nymphs dancing in a ballet, under the leadership of Amalia Ferraris. In vogue, all wearing under their gauzy skirts frightful green drawers, which made them look like so many frogs stung by a tarantula, pale, with woeful eyes, and the general air of one crushed by suffering, Octavian seemed to doubt the reality of what had transpired upon the stage, so difficult that he find it to resume the sentiments of real life after the marvelous adventure of the night. From the time of that visit to Pompeii, Octavian fell into a dismal melancholy, which the good-humored pleasantry of his companions rather aggravated than soothed. The image of Arria Marcella haunted him incessantly, and the sad termination of his fantastic good fortune had never destroyed its charm. Unable to contain his misery, he returned secretly to Pompeii, and once again wandered among the ruins by moonlight, as before, his heart palpitating with maddening hope. But the hallucination never returned. He saw only the lizards fleeing over the stones. He heard only the screams of the startled night birds. He met his friend Rufus no more. Tai Chi came not to lay her supple hand upon his arm. and Arria Marcella obstinately slumbered in her dust. Abandoning all hope, Octavian finally married a charming young English girl who was madly in love with him. He is perfectly well behaved to his wife, but Ellen, with that subtle instinct of the heart, which nothing can deceive, feels that her husband is enamored of another. But of whom? That is a mystery which the most unflagging watchfulness cannot enable her to unravel. Octavian never entertains actresses. In society, he addresses to women only the most commonplace gallantries. He even returned, with the greatest coldness, the marked advances of a certain Russian princess, celebrated for her beauty and coquetry. A secret drawer, opened during her husband's absence, afforded no confirmation of infidelity to Ellen's suspicions. But how could she permit herself to be jealous of Arria Marcella? And this, my darling, ends our story time for today. As always, I hope that you have very sweet and creepy dreams.